consentement. En tout cas, nous sommes très heureux.
We are very happy to have received this vaccine. Ebola is a disease that is difficult to treat, and the virus is often fatal. So here in the DRC, we are so lucky to have been vaccinated.
Well, health officials have declared an end to an Ebola outbreak in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. It only took 3 months compared to the last outbreak in West Africa that raged on for 4 years. This time, 33 people died, but that's compared to more than 11,000 that were killed in the previous epidemic. So why the drastic difference? Well, the World Health Organization deployed medics within days, armed with an experimental vaccine that destroyed the virus even as it reached a major metropolitan area. So can the success in the DRC prevent the next Ebola crisis? To discuss this, I'm joined from Brazzaville by Dr. Ibrahima-Soce, who is the WHO's Regional Emergencies Director in Africa. Thanks so much for speaking to us. Let me begin with asking, how did you do it? How did you tackle Ebola so successfully in the DRC? Was it all about that experimental vaccine?
Thank you so much. Let me first of all congratulate the Democratic Republic of Congo and all partners who have been working with us to contain this outbreak. I think the first thing we need to talk about is really the rapid report and transparency from the Congo. So the same day the outbreak was confirmed, we got the information in WHO, and we were able to do a rapid risk assessment and to deploy a team to start working with the country and Congo. So we were able to do this because of the profound reform we went through after the Ebola outbreak in West Africa. So now we are much more better prepared. We know the risk. We know how exactly we can deploy our team very quickly to be on the ground. And we have a new mechanism for financing. So we were able, the same day the outbreak was confirmed, to deploy $2 million from our contingency fund for emergencies. And with our new incident management system, we are able to send team within hours and days to affected countries. So we have a set of processes and more capacity to respond to this type of outbreak. So in addition to traditional means, we have this new vaccine, of course, and we are able to vaccinate the contacts of cases, the contacts of contacts, and health workers at frontline. So those people were at high risk, but we vaccinated over 3,300 people and none of them developed Ebola, meaning that this vaccine may have played an important role in stopping the transmission.
Okay, but is it fair to say you learned some very hard lessons from the experience in West Africa on how to prevent this going forward?
Exactly, because during the Ebola outbreak in West Africa, we realized that countries, partners, the entire world were expecting more from WHO in terms of operation. But the organization was not set to do operation at this magnitude. So it was important to go through this reform to learn a lot in terms of working with community, in terms of rapid deployment, in terms of using some of the emergency SOPs to be able to work directly with countries and partners in the field, and to be able to coordinate a whole range of partners using the incident management system.
Understood. But I mean, you can never rest on your laurels. So where could the next serious threat be? We've already seen an outbreak, for example, of the bubonic plague in Madagascar that has made its way over to parts of the east coast of Africa. What areas are you looking at for the next big prevention effort?
So in Africa, we are using what we call evidence-based preparedness. We have done a comprehensive risk assessment of potential outbreak in our region. Of course, we have what we used to call viral hemorrhagic fevers like Ebola, Marburg, but we have also all type of disease. We have a number of vector-borne diseases, and with climate change and more countries are at risk. We have seen dengue fever, we have seen Zika, we have seen, you know, yellow fever. So we are working with countries based on the risk assessment and the capacity and gaps to help them to build their system to be better prepared to all kind of hazards. So we are using the multi-hazard approach for evidence-based preparedness.
Okay, but can I talk about some of the, hone in on some of the micro examples here, if I can call them that. First of all, has Ebola, can you say it has been eradicated, or are you still having to heavily monitor that? And the bubonic plague, particularly in Madagascar, where is that going?
We cannot say Ebola has been eradicated because virus reservoir is in the forest, and we know some animals are carrying the virus. So we still have the risk, but the most important thing is to be able to educate the population to prevent this outbreak and also to be able to detect it and control it very quickly. For Madagascar, plague is endemic in Madagascar, but we are able to set up a strong surveillance system and also starting working with the countries in terms of prevention because the matter of hygiene and sanitation and so on. So it's important to continue to work with the country to address all the determinants, because when you have this social condition and linked to the poverty and poor living condition, the plague will still be a risk. But now we are working with them to have a longer term plan instead of just responding to the outbreaks they have been having every year. They are working around a longer term plan to eradicate plague in Madagascar.
Okay, overall, you sound very optimistic. I'll just ask you point blank, are there any things that really keep you up at night, though, as far as the big challenges to come?
So as I'm speaking, we are still responding and monitoring to close to 60 outbreaks in Africa. And every year we have more than 120 outbreaks, meaning that we still have a lot to do because we have many weaknesses in the health system. So we need to work very closely with countries and partners to invest in the health system strengthening to be able to prevent, for example, vaccine-preventable diseases. We are still seeing yellow fever outbreak, measles outbreak where we have the vaccine. So it's important really to strengthen the system to make sure that we anticipate and mitigate the risk to be able to really focus on the outbreak we cannot prevent. But
okay,
the most important is really on the prevention side and strengthening the health system.
Okay, Dr. Ibrahima-Soce, I'd like to thank you so much for joining us there from Brazzaville on this edition of The Newsmakers.
It happened so suddenly, at 6 in the morning. Suddenly everything simply collapsed. My child was inside the house. Thankfully, he survived.
Tomorrow morning, at the latest, considering the requests from the victims, funds to help them rebuild their houses will be dispersed.
That's all for this edition of The Newsmakers with me, Andrea Sankey. Check out more of our stories on YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. Remember to like, follow, and subscribe. Next time, we head to Las Vegas to look at what happens when the victims of a mass shooting get sued. Until then, thanks for watching. Goodbye.